Today on the show, I'm chatting with Boston real estate guru, Mr. Collin Bray. We talk innovative ways to use social media to market your business, especially real estate, the beauty of Boston and the Back Bay, a little bit of sports, and his phenomenal James Bond research skills. So stay tuned. Hi, everyone. This is Sandy Adams, and you're listening to a Southern Girls View podcast. We're back today. I have on the show real estate guru Collin Bray. I knew I was going to screw that up. Collin Bray, he's the vice president of sales at Century 21 Cityside in Boston, Massachusetts. And today we're talking real estate, marketing, the pandemic, and maybe just a little bit of sports and anything else that comes up. So welcome to the show.
I love that. Thank you. Appreciate the warm welcome. No one's ever called me a guru before, but there is a reason. I have two L's in my name. Funny story. When I was born, my parents wanted to make sure that kids didn't tease me in the schoolyard, and they didn't want to call me Colin, so they gave me two L's. So it was. They made sure kids would call me Colin. So thanks, Mom and Dad. Appreciate that.
And I screwed that up immediately. It's funny because I also, I have a co-teacher. I teach one day a week, and I have a co-teacher's name is Royce, and I always call him Ross. I don't know why. It just comes out. So I apologize ahead of time, especially when I'm thinking about something, then I end up messing it up even more.
That's okay. For our listeners, it's a fun way to introduce.
It is.
And get connected. And we have not prepared for this at all. So
no.
I have no questions that she's filtered me. You know, I haven't slept on my answers. We're going to give you raw and uncut, and we're going to have a lot of fun.
That is exactly right. So just for our listeners out there a little bit, because this is actually the first time you and I have actually met. So for the listeners out there, I'm in Houston, and you are in Boston, Massachusetts. My sister lives there, and she were following each other on Instagram, and I run her Instagram account. And I just started noticing you started commenting on stuff that she did and sharing it. And I was like, who is this guy? And then I started following your Instagram account. And your Instagram stories is what drew me in. And I just love those. And so we're going to talk a little bit about that today and kind of what went into that. But let's start off. So I saw on your Instagram stories, by the way, that you went running this morning.
I did. It's actually why I'm wearing a t-shirt. I'm still kind of sweating. I have this knit cap on. And so, of course, my hair is not perfect. You know, I have this whole thing of trying to make sure everything's in its right place, and perfection is important, but that's not the case today. So actually, I did do a run this morning around the Charles River.
Okay.
So Boston is really an incredible city.
It is.
And made up of a number of different neighborhoods. My office is located in the Back Bay. And it's a historic district, so lots of, 100-plus-year-old brownstones. Now we have a lot of new modern buildings and surrounding neighborhoods, luxury high-rises. And I'm in the real estate business, so we help clients buy, sell, and invest. We're going to talk a lot about marketing today, and that's really important for a realtor. But also important at this point in time to get outside, to exercise, to take care of yourself and your body, so that you can take care of your loved ones.
That's correct. Now, did you grow up in Boston?
Born and raised with no accent.
I know, that is crazy. How did you get away from it? But I don't really have a Tennessee accent either, I don't think.
You have a little Southern charm accent. Maybe I have one as well, and I just don't notice it. But I actually grew up in Brookline, Massachusetts, which is a town right next to Boston and close to Fenway Park. Where the Red Sox play.
Yes. It's interesting because, and I've got, my window is distracting me, and the kids next door are playing basketball. Before I moved to Houston, I've been in Houston 15 years. Before I moved here, I would go to Boston every single summer. That's what I would do. And after a while, you can only do so many things in the city. And so my sister and I used to make theme trips outside the city. I'm very well aware and doing a lot of her social media. And I also run the Sudbury social media, in case you didn't know that as well.
I did not know that. And for our listeners, the Sudbury is a brand new, beautiful, luxury high rise that has rentals up to a certain floor, and then luxury condos for sale at the upper floors, and these are like panoramic, incredible views. I went up in the building actually about a week and a half ago.
Yes, you did.
I put the hard hat on. I had like the yellow vest. You know, I was up in this like scary elevator, but we previewed the building while it's under construction, and that's something actually that's really important for realtors to do, is to really understand and know the inventory. And I think as I was previewing the building, I was taking stories and adding it to Instagram to promote to my followers, like what's happening. Because a lot of people don't know when these buildings are being built, like what are they gonna be?
Well, exactly. That's a very good thing. For me, it was really hard because I had to understand what was near the building. And that took me a little while to kind of get myself oriented and know, you know, what, because I share a lot of the neighborhood. So I really had to understand what was in the neighborhood, and I had to understand what that client would be and what that client would be interested in.
And how did you figure that out? How did you learn about the neighborhood not being here, you know, physically?
Well, a little bit of it was obviously Brenda was kind of helping me and guiding me, you know, these are the clients that we are looking at. And a little bit of backstory in that, I had already been running a smaller neighborhood outside of Boston. I'd been running a residential development there as well. So I was already kind of familiar with the real estate and marketing for real estate. But the Sudbury was a different type of client. So it was really just trial and error, and her and I talking about, you know, these are the counts to follow, and this is the area of town, and me just getting a map out. And when I would, because I don't want to have to keep asking her, is this one okay? Is this one? So I really took a map out and then just started looking at what are the things there and do they fit in with the plan?
It's interesting because you're saying a few things that are really, really important and great for our listeners, right? So whether you're in any sales business and not just real estate, one is, you know, kind of understanding who potential clientele is.
That's right.
Right. So who's the demographic that might buy your product? In this case, it's, you know, who's going to buy a luxury condominium with incredible views on one level of living with services?
Right.
You know, I think someone like that might be living in the suburbs in a house and looking to come into the city and want kind of a palatial floor plan with a lot of living area, but not have to deal with snow removal and stairs and all of the things that go into living and keeping up a single family home. The other thing that I thought was brilliant that you said, which is really understanding the neighborhood.
Yes.
Right. So the Sudbury in Boston is located kind of like, we'll call it like in a fringe neighborhood. It like is on the border between the North End, which is like the Italian neighborhood with incredible food and in history and culture. And then you're really close to what's called the West End, which, you know, is where the Bruins and the Celtics play. But then you're also on the fringe of Beacon Hill, which is a historic and charming neighborhood with lots of brownstones. And so it's also kind of like giving the area an identity.
Yes, it really is. And I have to become the building, and I have to make the building a person. And that was something that I really enjoyed doing. And a lot of people think social media marketing, which we're going to get into a little bit more, but a lot of people think that social media marketing is just, hey, I've got something for sale, buy my services. And they're constantly just selling, and it's not. It's creating something that people want to come back to. I found a real estate agent in Wilmington, North Carolina, because her Instagram posts, I didn't even realize she was a realtor. And I just liked her Instagram posts. She did like White Wednesday, and she would have these incredible rooms. And obviously they spoke to me. And if I move to Wilmington, North Carolina, she's my realtor. I don't even care if she, like, that was really what connected me to her. And that was kind of what connected me to your stories is too. They took on more than just, you weren't selling. You were educating me, whether you realized it or not. And it was.
Well, and and that's important when you talk about any neighborhood in sales. And for a realtor, you know, the first question you typically ask people is, where is it you want to live? You know, and where means like, where, how close is that to work?
Right.
How close is that to the gym?
Yeah.
Where do you like to go grocery shopping? Where do you like to go out to eat? You know, it's like the whole idea of a neighborhood is like live, work, and play.
Right.
And so really understanding that and then being able to actually communicate and articulate that through video, still photography, you know, writing, so copy. There's many different ways to do it. And I found the most effective way is to do it your way. So to not look at what other people are doing.
That's right.
And share, you know, really a feeling and an experience that you would think's valuable. And you know, kind of like grassroots marketing campaign.
It
you
is.
Know, my motto for marketing, the most important rule that I live by that's made me different is to look and evaluate what other people are doing in the marketplace and do the complete opposite.
Exactly.
That's my brand.
And so it's interesting because there's one Instagram story that I really loved that you did. And I actually, I teach a class once a week and it's a job search class. So I teach mid-level executives how to find a job that have been laid off in the internet age. And a lot of them are engineers. They've got master's degrees. A lot of them have PhDs and they don't have an idea how to market themselves and they're suddenly having to learn. But there was one Instagram post that you did that I talk about all the time. You literally stopped in front of this brownstone and you talked about you had driven by it so many times and it had been vacant and you finally, like, you spent 6 months trying to write to the owner, I think that was the story, and wanting to sell it for him or her, and he finally agreed. And then you did an Instagram story walking through the building and just talking about it. And I thought that was really incredible that you saw something that you wanted and you kept after it. Mm. And you found a way to connect yourself. And I believe you wrote a letter, actually, to the owner.
A handwritten card, yeah.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. Which has now become like my specialty.
And because I talk a lot about don't do what other people are doing, like you and I talked about. Go back to old school. People don't walk in and say hello to people anymore. And I know not all businesses you can walk into, but try to do something that other people are not doing. And I think people look at the easiest way now. And I just, to me, that sold me immediately on you as a realtor, because it just showed beyond real estate, it just showed that you had a connection and you cared about getting something done and solving the needs for both the owner and the prospective future buyer. How long did it take you to sell that property?
Oh, that process took over a year.
Okay.
And, you know, a few things just to highlight before I tell the story in like hyper speed, because it's a long story, but I'll make it
That's
short.
Okay.
You know, one part of that story is, you know, we all kind of, we walk neighborhoods. I love walking around. By the way, that's a great tip for any realtor. And the neighborhood in which you want to focus and specialize in, and if you don't know what it is, think in your mind, like, where do I like to spend my time and what lights me up when I'm in that area?
Good deal.
For me, it happens to be the Back Bay.
Right.
You know, it's just really special and charming and has this neighborhood feel. I cannot explain. You have to come to Boston.
That's right. You do. That's true.
And then you'll see it. So this building I walked past and noticed, actually, I was selling a condominium next door and I kept seeing the building because it was very strange. This is a very high net worth area. This is a kind of a very unique street. There are townhomes that sell for north of $10 million on this street. So to have a building there sitting empty, vacant with boarded up was very strange. And my guess is there are many realtors that had walked past this building and just said, oh, that's kind of interesting. But what I did is I saw it and I said, ooh, this is an opportunity.
Right.
And part of that is then taking action and not being stopped. Right. So one example is the building is held in a trust. And if most people find that a building's held in a trust, it's kind of hard to find then who manages that trust. And there's a lot of 007 research that goes into right? So like, I reference myself, I'm kind of goofy, right? I'm like, oh, I'm the 007.
That's okay. Like, that's what I tell my students. I'm like, be a detective.
Yeah, I find that kind of fascinating. It's like my superhero alter ego, right? I'll be like the 007 realtor. So, you know, normally where I think most people get stopped is where I was like, oh, now I really have to find out who the owner is. So after research, weeks and weeks of research, I finally found out who the owner was. And interestingly enough, they happened to be the co-owner of the Boston Celtics.
Oh, really?
Oh, really? So then you wonder, geez, someone who owns the Celtics, why is this building empty?
Yeah.
No, they didn't. I'm sure they didn't run out of money.
Right, right.
So I then wrote them a handwritten card, and it felt kind of like a Hail Mary. You know, like, geez, I don't know.
How'd you get the address?
I found out who the owner was. Mm-hmm. I did a search in the tax records. Okay. Their address is actually hidden, but I found a parcel of land that they owned. I did a Google Map search. I then took my car and drove by to see that the house actually existed and was built, because it only shows up as a parcel of land. Right. And realized that was their single family residence. And I wrote them a handwritten card to that address.
Wow.
And then I waited for 6 months. They didn't respond. And out of nowhere, 6 months later, the owner writes me an email and says, "We would consider selling the home at what price?"
Oh my God.
So then I'll fast forward the story. Over the next 6 months, I gave her a price. She gave me access to show the building.
Right.
I showed it. We then negotiated for another few months, and then actually ended up selling the property for $4,725,000.
So I have a couple of questions. So when you talked to her, did she say why she chose to respond to your letter or your card?
No, she didn't. She said that she had been quite busy, but appreciated that I reached out, and that she was thinking about selling because she was so busy with other projects that she was doing.
So why had it been sitting vacant and boarded up? She just didn't have time to deal with it?
They actually had bought multiple brownstones on that street.
Okay.
And for whatever reason, could not get a garage built on the back of this one because of the building being historically protected. And they were able to get relief on another building, which they ended up building and are now going to be living in soon. And this building, just ended up making some money on it and just not doing the project.
Was she very happy after the sale?
You know, I'd say the buyer was happier than the seller. I've never met the seller. It was all conducted. Never. I got access to show the home. It was all negotiated on the phone and via email. We've never met face to face.
That's pretty amazing. It is very amazing. But I like that whole story because, yes, it took you a while, but you ended up with a success story, which is not always the case. But because I talk a lot about to my students, a lot of times ask me, because we tell them to be politely persistent. And so a lot of times they want to know, when should they stop? And I said, I can't answer that because it depends on you and how long you want to risk it or keep going and how much time is invested, you know, how much you're willing to invest in it. And that can be different for everybody. But what I guess for you, you sent the card. And if she had not responded in a year, would you have sent another one? Or were you close to sending another card?
Well, it's tough. Once you make contact with someone and there's a dialogue, right, then I think it's a lot easier to follow up.
Yes, it is.
And in this case, you know, I texted or I emailed, you know, once a month or once every month and a half just to check in with her. Because for her, it wasn't about needing to sell.
Right, exactly.
I didn't need to sell. It was more about selling at the right time. And that meant probably not me pestering her.
Right.
Like, what could be more annoying than a pestering realtor when someone doesn't need to sell?
Exactly.
So following up the right time was more important. But if she didn't respond, yeah, I probably would not have written another card, you know, and sent it into oblivion, just hoping to get a response. So I think, you know, once you have a response, that's an open line of communication.
Yes.
And that's a welcoming to say, yes, I'm interested.
That is a really great story. So I do pay attention to your Instagrams.
You do.
I do.
Now you have most of the whole story.
I do call my sister quite a lot talking about, oh my God, you should have seen what he posted today. So people, at least I do. It really, really catches my eye.
Appreciate
so what is the biggest thing that you love about living in Boston? Like if you could say, what's your favorite thing about Boston? One thing.
One thing immediately comes to mind is passionate people.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
What is the thing? Okay, go ahead. Sorry.
No, go ahead. Sorry.
What I was going to say is, what would be the thing that bugs you about Boston?
Ooh, that bugs me about Boston. Not much bugs me. it's I think we've got an amazing city. I always think about the positives.
Right.
And, you know, our city is growing so fast that now we start to have complaints about, you know, traffic and things like that. Right. But that's a good thing. Right. We are really becoming a world-class city.
Yes.
With world-class jobs and a really strong economy. And that is a reflection of the real estate market.
Right. I Googled this before we got on. So Boston is listed as the 24th largest city. And it's completely different from Houston, because Houston's the fourth largest city, but the whole dynamics is totally different. Like here, you drive everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
It's so spread out. I live in a suburb of Houston, so it takes me about 40 minutes to get into the actual city. And so when I'm talking with my sister, you know, she's like, you live in a whole different world. I'm like, I do. Just not only the weather, but just how we live generally, because everybody drives here. It's very...
Yeah, Boston is very much a walking city.
It is.
That should have been my number one answer, right? That's a really good point. But I'll give you an example, right? So I drove from my house to my office. I got out of my car and I walked a block down Newbury Street. Newbury Street is like the Rodeo Drive.
Yes, it is.
Of Boston. So luxury shops, restaurants, great, you know, places to eat, coffee shops. And then I walked one block over and I was on Commonwealth Avenue. So 100 plus year old brownstones,
yes.
Beautiful, you know, mansions, brick buildings, limestone, really charming, tree-lined street. Feels like you're in Europe. Then
right.
I walked one more block over and I ran down the Charles River, the Esplanade. So it's this very, very long stretch that goes down the river. That's like a walking path, running path. People do picnics there. They bring their babies, their dogs.
Right.
And then I walked over to another neighborhood, Beacon Hill. And then, you know, if I wanted to, I could walk over to the South End. So everything's very connected.
It is.
It's a very big, small city, if that's a good example.
It is. So let's go back to social media. Are you just on Instagram, or are you on Facebook as well and Twitter?
So I'm on Twitter, but don't really use it unless I'm watching like ESPN basketball videos.
That's right. I do it for just mainly
good,
sports. Yeah, just yeah. Sports.
Sports is great. LinkedIn. I'm
yes.
very
yes.
positive and heavy into LinkedIn.
So we're actually connected on LinkedIn, in case I think you did know I was her sister on LinkedIn.
Okay.
Maybe.
Well, I know now. I think LinkedIn's really
it is.
Underutilized.
I agree.
To get to communicate your message and your brand and to share stories.
I agree.
And then I'm on Facebook and, of course, Instagram as well.
So do you get clients from any of those social media platforms?
Not really.
Okay.
And it's not ultimately why I do it. You know, Facebook can be a great lead generation. Mm-hmm. Source in terms of advertising, boosting posts, promoting properties. Really why I promote and tell my story and tell my client's story is a way to create a brand.
Right.
An awareness and a following. So if my number one reason were just to generate leads, I think that my branding and my story and what I shared would be very different. And we probably wouldn't be having this conversation right now.
That is correct. Do any of your clients follow you on Instagram?
Absolutely. And I'm connected to a lot of them on Instagram, on LinkedIn and Facebook. So definitely I'm connected with clients. Very important.
Does that connection come before or after they become your client?
I think a few of them have come before, but most of them it's after the transaction, or you know, they're looking to interview me or meet with me, and I,
right.
you know, connect with them socially.
I would think that them connecting with you afterwards would be a great sense of they already know you, they already have the connection. And then the more they see, the more they're excited to refer you.
I hope. And if they don't, then at least they'll be excited to work with me again when the time comes.
Sure, exactly.
Because they can see that I'm very active and right. they can see that success, because people do want to work with people that they know, like, and trust.
Exactly.
And are also successful.
Exactly. I say that so much. That's what I tell my students, that you can't just expect somebody to give you a job if they don't know you. There has to be a process. And I talk about, there's another photographer in town, because I love Instagram. It's my favorite platform. And this other photographer and I had actually been, we've never met, and we had connected on Instagram, and I love her photography. She does a lot of sceneries, and she's really great at Photoshop, and they look like paintings, and she does a lot of animals as well. But she and I had been following each other for a couple of years, and a year ago at Christmas, she referred me to one of her clients. They wanted a family shoot. And so she referred them to me. The woman called me. We chatted over the phone. She paid me in advance, booked me, and never met me. Mm. And then I show up at, you know, to do her shoot. And I talk a lot about, you know, there was that trust, because the photographer and I had built up this trust. She knew me. She started knowing me better, liking me, and then the trust came. And so I really do talk about that process, that no matter what you're in, it's really important. And that's how social media can really help if you use it the right way.
Really, you're talking about them already trusting you and having kind of like pre-screened your work already.
Exactly, exactly.
And ultimately hiring you before they even met you.
Yeah, and that's not the first time that's happened. I've had a couple of other people that before that ever met them, they had already hired me, some through email, not even talking to me.
Mm. Let me ask you a question. Do you have a business page?
Yes.
And a personal page for Insta and Facebook, or how does that work?
So for me, for Instagram, I have a personal account. I have not made it into a quote business account. The reason being is because I think that Instagram, because Facebook owns it, will eventually go to where they're going to penalize the people with business accounts. Mm. And it's going to be harder to get pushed up in the algorithm. So on Instagram, they don't penalize you as much as they do on Facebook. On Facebook, you can get knocked off if you use your personal page for business purposes. Instagram, yeah. Not so much. So I've kept it a personal account, but it's strictly a business.
Got
so
it.
I have that. And I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, I was going to say, it's funny because I get that question often, which is, what should I do? Should I have two pages? Should I have one? Bring me the best results?
I'm kind of crazy because I have two different businesses, and then I have four Instagram pages or Instagram accounts. One is my photography, one's social media and education, one's my travels, and then one's for my dogs. Mm. And my dogs actually became a part of my marketing because I talk about them so much, and I use them as a part of my brand, so to speak, that my clients started hiring me just because I had dogs or because I was a dog lover. And then I realized I can't post pictures about my dogs all the time on my photography page. So I created a separate account. But a lot of that was because my specialty is history. So I wanted to use my dogs to educate the public about historical places, because we did a lot of traveling. So I was using that. That's kind of, I haven't put a lot of energy into it, but all my clients have started following my dog's account.
So, I love that idea, by the way.
Yeah. So it's kind of become, four pages is a lot to take care of. And then plus the ones that people pay me for. But then on Facebook, it's the same way. I have four pages there as well. Okay. And match that. And I really tried to create a brand. And then me, I'm the overall brand. So a little bit of it, I make it a little bit different on each page, but ultimately it's still me as a brand. And that was one thing when I moved to Texas, was there's photographers everywhere. How can I set myself apart? And for me, that brand was that I was from Tennessee, that I was a Southern girl. because people here were from Texas, and they're not the same thing. Texas is Southern. So that, you know, that was another way where I set myself apart doing that. And I started off doing videos, behind the scenes videos, because I loved Vogue magazine and Vanity Fair. And so I started off doing behind the scenes videos before anybody else here really got into videos at all. I was doing that. So, yeah.
Yeah, it's interesting. You know, it's important in figuring out how you can brand yourself differently. And this goes for realtors or contractors, developers, or anyone that's creating a niche. You know, I find number one is it's okay to have your business and your personal page to be one. I personally only have one Instagram account. I run it myself. And the reason I do that is, you know, like, business is personal for me. Like, I'll share about my family or about me going for a run.
And
then the story about, you know, us helping clients buy and sell real estate as well. To me, they're all kind of interconnected.
Yes, I totally agree with you. Totally agree with you on that.
So for someone that's wondering, what should I do? That's, you know, it's different for everyone, as you can see. But good to know that you can just have one and have it win.
Yes. And I, you know, I get questions occasionally about how much should I share personally on my business stuff. And for me, I said, if people look at my account, they're just going to think I'm a photographer, I travel, and I'm a crazy dog lady. That's really what they're going to think. But for me, people may think that's a lot of personality involved, but it's not, you know, but it's what I put out, and it makes people feel like they're getting a huge part of me.
They're getting to know you without ever knowing you.
Exactly. Yeah. That's very true. So let's talk about when did you start thinking that Instagram stories was something you wanted to get into, and how did you get so creative? Because you're pretty creative on your stories, pretty creative.
Yeah. Well, one is, you know, you don't know what you're kind of good at or what you like, really what you enjoy, until you try it. Until you participate. And so, interestingly enough, I was having a conversation with someone via text, and I asked him, you know, are you posting on the story on Instagram? Because he acknowledged me. He said something similar about him enjoying following me and like what I was sharing. Right. I said, hey, are you posting? And he said, no, I'm not. I said, well, what are you passionate about? He goes, I love real estate and I love cars. I go, beautiful. So you should start to post about that. And don't forget about your family too.
Yeah.
You know, you got to share the personal side as well. And he said, oh, you know, it's kind of a good idea. That's a good place to start. So for anyone, you got to start with your passion.
That's right.
And you're sharing your passion, it makes it so much easier.
It does. Yes, yeah. It does. And you connect with people. For me, I connect with people that are not just dog lovers or animal lovers, but people that may not have pets but still like them. I also do share a little bit of sports in there. But here in Texas, it's not basketball, it's football. And
that's okay.
So
I guess to answer your question, I didn't know until I just started trying.
Right.
And I think, you know, for everyone, you know, being a little curious and just being adventurous and taking a little bit of risk. Like, hey, I don't have this whole Instagram thing figured out, but let's try it, right? So that's like one thing, like maybe not knowing, going a little bit to the unknown.
Right.
And then the second is like I said, sharing your passion. So for me, like I love beautiful real estate. And there's something about sharing the story behind real estate. So when you think about real estate, like someone might look at a house, for example, and they'll see four walls and a roof and a door. And like when I look at a house, or a luxury condominium, I think about like what DNA does this house have? So like what makes it unique, like human beings? So I think about the history. So like, wonder who owned this house before? Like when was it built? And then I think about the neighborhood. What makes this street really special and different? I think about, you know, the improvements that the current homeowners have made. So what makes this home more valuable or more interesting or special than maybe the comps, you know, neighboring homes that are sold. So really trying to dig in to tell the story about the home, like, excites me. That stuff lights me up. It's like being on the court, you know, and like playing basketball and like you know, passing someone like the ball to the corner to hit a three-pointer to win the game. Like,
right.
There's nothing more exciting and thrilling than a challenge,
right?
And to tell a story.
So let's talk about other real estate agents, maybe in smaller cities or in cities where there's a lot of new developments. So you've heard those, they're mass community properties that are just built up and they create a whole thing there. What would you suggest to real estate agents in those type of areas where the real estate is not historical? A lot, there's probably 5-4 plans for the entire neighborhood, but there's so many of those neighborhoods, because here south of Houston, we have a lot of those neighborhoods. So there's not a lot of history. What would you recommend to real estate agents in that type of environment? Because that's kind of the completely opposite of where you're at.
Sure. Well, first of all, for any real estate agent not in, you know, an urban city, a metro city, like, what an opportunity it is for you in your marketplace. Do you know that there's probably a real estate agent on every single corner?
Yes.
In Boston? There is so much competition. And I welcome competition, but, you know, to be in a neighborhood or a town or a city where there's far less licensed agents, like, what an opportunity. And, you know, I guess I think Boston has so much history that if your town doesn't maybe have that type of history, well, then maybe you want to think about the future, right? So what I mean by that is, what makes this subdevelopment special? What type of technology upgrades can you get the home?
Yeah.
You know, what type of like smart home is the developer creating? And then like, what's the future neighborhood going to be? You know, what is the city planning on putting in the surrounding areas? Maybe they're planning on another subdivision, right? That could help your value.
Right.
Maybe they're planning on putting in new shops or new restaurants. You know, so learning about what's coming soon or in the future that's in development is really valuable. For example, if I were to sell something at the Sudbury, I probably wouldn't just talk about the Sudbury. What I would talk about is like the whole emergence of this new neighborhood,
right,
that's smack dab in the middle between the North End, Beacon Hill, and, you know, and it really just kind of a niche neighborhood that's being created. Like, that's the
yes.
future.
Right.
So that's what I would do.
Okay, so let's take a 5-minute break. I have to take my dog out. Just a minute break. Hang on.
Okay,
so let's change the topic now from social media. Let's talk about just briefly about the pandemic and how the current situation has affected your real estate business and kind of how you've changed your communication or you're selling because of the current situation.
Sure. Well, there's a few things, you know, to consider first for context, right? This pandemic is, you know, affecting everyone. And, you know, social distancing means that real estate, you know, cannot be sold or really shown
right.
in the traditional fashion, right? So previously, people would show up and show houses and you'd be close to your agent. And you'd be in someone else's home and, you know, you would open things, you would touch things, right? You want to open the
right.
appliances, you want to open the closets. And now what we're seeing is because of this situation, that can't happen anymore. So, you know, what is the solution to, number one, keep people safe, but also, you know, help people move, because there's a lot of people that need to sell
yes.
or be being relocated for jobs, or are having babies and need more space, or even the worst one, which is breaking up and really want to get out.
Yes.
So there's a lot of reasons why people move. So what's happening in Boston is they're highly recommending, the mayor is saying, no open houses and limit private showings.
Okay.
So most brokers are not having open houses. And if they do, they're kind of just like scheduling private viewings with one party in the house.
But, right.
You know, you're not having a big group of 10 or 20 people, because previously they let everyone in the house. There might be 20 people that would see a place at the same time. They all be in the same room.
Right.
So what's happening now? First of all, I've got, you know, probably 20 face masks in my car. I've got shoe covers, I've got gloves, I've got sanitizer, So I have this new process in place for showings. Mm-hmm. And a lot of it's done through virtual tours now. So right. the era of video showings, FaceTimes, and virtual tours is definitely become the way to rent, buy, and sell real estate. And I think will be the wave of the future.
I definitely agree too. And it was, you know, something like all the colleges here and I think across the country have now have trained all the teachers that were not online teachers. Suddenly all the classes are becoming online. And the one class that I do teach, it's actually online now too, which we've kind of been pushing as well. But I even saw like a car dealership here was advertising that you could see your cars like online now. Like that's how you would choose to buy it. And then they would drop it off and you could mm-hmm. do all the signing of the papers online as well, which in some ways I think is kind of better because I've been in that situation where the car dealership kept me there for 5 hours and it just became this horrible experience.
Well, you might have been a really tough negotiator, or maybe they just did the.
No, they didn't even offer me coffee or anything. Like it was a horrible experience. Yeah. But the other thing is, you know, as much as we talk about, because I hear people all the time complaining about social media, and it really comes down to how people use it. If you use it in a positive way, then you're going to get good rewards back. My mom, before she passed away, we had taught her, or she taught herself how to get in. She had her own Facebook page. She would get online every day and look at my account, my sister's, my brother's accounts, my niece's. She knew more about her grandkids than she did prior to being on Facebook. And then the last few years when she couldn't get out of the house, she even started doing video chats. Mm. So for me, I think social media has so many good positive rewards. And you look at right now where everybody is staying at home or supposed to be staying at home, and suddenly everybody's using FaceTime more. People are actually talking to people more. I was laughing because I was like, I grew up on a farm pretty much by myself. So for me, and I work at home a lot by myself. So for me, it's not really any different. But last night on Instagram, there is this celebrity DJ. He had been DJing in his home for like 5 hours. He had 87,000 people in the United States online enjoying his music.
Yeah, well, there's two things to consider. One is he was probably like having the time of his life.
He was, right? He'd been doing it all week long.
Doing what he loves.
Yeah.
And the second is, you know, he was able to create this 87,000 person following is because yes. No one had to go to work, right?
That's right.
So there were some circumstances. Yeah. There, it's interesting because I actually had a little situation. I think mindset is actually really important. You mentioned yes. The word positivity.
Yes.
And it's tough to be positive, especially when you know you care about people's health and well-being, right. And you see how right. Everyone's doing well. But for example, in real estate, I had a scheduled call for a request for a client of mine.
I think I think your internet went down for just a second, so whatever the start of that story was didn't take, so if you could just repeat it.
Okay, am I good now?
Yes, you're good now.
Good. So the story that I was going to share is just a conversation with a seller client who asked to have a phone call about how we were prepared to create a protocol for people entering and showing the home.
Right.
Because as much as we're doing FaceTime videos, there's still a lot of people that want to walk through and see a space.
Right.
And that's the norm. So what I did was I kind of went into this mindset of like, ugh, like now I have to have this phone call right. And talk about the issue and, you know, what do I have to create? And, you know, I have to solve this problem. And then I had a coaching call because I have a coach, and I think having a coach is really important because I'm really into self-development and growth. And the coach helped me shift my mindset to, instead of I have to have this conversation and I have to, you know, create this process for this problem we have, is I get to. Like, right, what an opportunity that I get to keep people healthy and give my seller client confidence and peace of mind that, like, we have a process, we're going to make sure that everyone's taken care of, and ultimately, because of that, we're going to sell the home, and then they're going to move with their soon-to-be new baby and, like, create the next chapter in their life. Yes. Like, I get to create that with them. Like, what a freaking wonderful opportunity. So that mindset shift made a big difference in that experience and really in my life.
Yeah, we talk about that a whole lot as well. I think that, and I've even employed it because there are some shoots that I don't necessarily like doing. I don't like doing event shoots and things like that. And what I've started since I've been teaching mindset in my class was I've started talking to myself the same way instead of, oh my God, I'm dreading doing this and I'm putting off preparing for it. I'm like, let me just go ahead and do it. And then I don't have to necessarily worry about it. And just getting through my mindset of this is what's going to happen and forcing myself to just go ahead and prep for it instead of putting it off. Okay. Last thing we're going to talk about is sports. Sports. Yes. Okay. So first, let's do a little bit about baseball. I'm not that big of a baseball fan. I actually have hated baseball, but I fell in love with baseball in the fifth inning of the 2017 World Series. And the Astros at the time, I just loved watching them play together as a city or as a team. And that was the summer I had just gone through a divorce. My mom had just died. I didn't have any family here in Houston, and I was sitting there and just kind of, that was one thing that just kind of lifted me up a little bit was just watching them play and the joy that they had. But then you fast forward to this year, and I've obviously the incident or whatever you want to call it, I call it the incident, the cheating scandal. So, and Boston has a little bit of connection to that because Alex, is it Cora? Alex Cora was your manager and he had been with the Astros in 2017, I believe, yes. And he was either forced to resign or he chose to resign, whatever that was.
I'm sure he was forced.
Yeah, I'm sure he was forced. But from your standpoint, in your opinion, do you think that it was right that the players were not punished? And because AJ Hinch was fired, I watched the press conference where he was fired and then the other guy was fired. I didn't necessarily agree with that. And a lot of people in Houston don't agree with them being fired because the players did not get reprimanded. But I did watch an interview that AJ Hinch did like 2 weeks after him getting fired. And that interview actually made me have less respect for him, if that could be possible, because...
Did the players know?
Yes, the players knew. They participated in it. And then AJ Hinch knew, and they actually were talking to him about, I guess in the report, it talked about he got so mad at one point that he took a baseball bat and broke one of their video devices. But then he said... he didn't say anything and he wished he had. And that was his way of like showing his displeasure. But I'm like, you're the manager of a World Series team and you don't think you have a right to say anything.
Sure.
So what's your opinion on, do you think the players should have been reprimanded? And then let's talk about Pete Rose. And do you think that he should be allowed back in baseball?
Well, it's really like a question for life, right? It's not just really about baseball. So it's a question about trying to get an edge and cheating and, you know, is that appropriate or is that ever allowed?
Right.
First of all, if the players knew and they were cheating and they ended up winning the World Series, then they should be stripped of the World Series. That's my opinion.
Right.
And the players should be suspended as well. It's simple, and the manager should have been fired, which he was.
Yes,
If he didn't know, and it was just the manager, it's a question of like if you're working and you're working in an office, and you know your boss is stealing money, and you don't know about it, you know, and they're fired, should you be punished? Probably not if you have no knowledge and no participation. But if you played in that game, then there's no gray area. It's black and white.
I do agree with that as well. So Pete Rose's lawyer came out after, like a couple of weeks after that whole thing came out, and they appealed to be let, for him to be let back into Major League Baseball. Do you have an opinion at all on that? Because,
nope.
Okay, that's fine. That's fine. So I do know, well, you told me that basketball is kind of your big thing. Is that correct?
Yep, hoops.
Okay. Yeah. Is it college or NBA or both?
Oh, it's both. NBA players are world class. It's incredible. And I played all my entire life. So elementary school, high school, I played in college. I still play a few times a week now. It's like my sanctuary. And also where I've created a lot of great relationships. Like there's nothing more than I like to do is get on the court and like try to have someone kick my ass and try to kick theirs. And then, you know, become friends and drink Bud Light after. Like, what could be better than that?
So obviously you probably follow the Boston Celtics.
Yes.
Okay. Do you follow a college team?
I like North Carolina, UNC.
Okay. Okay. Yep. Okay.
Fun fact, I played in the Dean Dome.
Oh, really?
Yeah. When I was in high school, we took a trip and we actually played in the Dean Dome. So that's a little...
Well, that's pretty cool. Where did you go to college at?
Colby Sawyer College.
Okay.
Go Chargers.
Where is that at?
That's in New London, New Hampshire. It's an incredible liberal arts school that is in this beautiful town called New London, going up 89, about an hour and a half from Boston. 89 okay. is the highway.
Okay. Okay. And what did you want to be when you were little? What did you want to grow up to be?
A motorcycle man.
Really? And why was that? Like, how did you come up with that? Or did you just think of that?
When I was a kid, my mother said, "What do you want to be when you grow up?" I said, "I want to be a motorcycle man." I swear, there's the honest answer. I did not want to get into real estate. I actually really struggled when I first got into real estate. Okay. I started to do apartment rentals, and I thought it was going to be easy. You know, that was my biggest mistake. I thought it was going to be easy. And I didn't put the work in when I first got into the business, which is a common theme now.
It is.
You just see HGTV or Bravo and they think it's really easy and it's a really challenging job.
But that's probably
why I've found success is, you know, I love a good challenge. And that started with sports. And I don't know why being a motorcycle man as a kid was what I wanted to be. Maybe it's the freedom of being out on the road. Maybe it's kind of like being a rogue and a little bit of a rebel.
Yeah. Which is it goes back to James Bond, the 007 thing. Yeah.
James Bond on a motorcycle. There you go.
Hey, Bond was on a motorcycle. He's been on a motorcycle.
Yeah, he's pretty cool. Yeah. Cool cat.
Have you seen all the movies, the James Bond movies?
I've seen most of them. Yeah.
Are you excited about? I'm kind of bummed the new one will be delayed. It won't be. It was supposed to be out in April, and it won't be released until later in the fall.
Oh, we'll have to wait.
Yeah, I know.
It's all right. Good things come with time.
That's right. Well, I'm going to end this now. Thank you so very much for doing this for me. I'm going to go ahead and get off now, but if you'll just hang on for 1 second.
Thanks, everyone.
Friends, I hope you really enjoyed today's conversation with Mr. Collin Bray, and I hope you learned a little bit as well. We both so appreciate you taking a few minutes out of your day to spend with us. For those wanting to see Collin's mad Instagram story skills, you can follow him on Instagram at Collin Bray. And if you're interested in his real estate services, then you can contact him direct through his website at collinbray.com. I have so many more interesting conversations coming up in the next few days and weeks. And as a reminder, if you're not already subscribed to my podcast, I want to encourage you to go do that today. I really don't want you to miss a single episode coming up. You can subscribe at southerngirlsview.podbean.com or on Apple Podcasts or iTunes at A Southern Girls View with Sandy Adams. You can also find me on iHeartRadio and Google Play Music. And if you're feeling extra warm and fuzzy, I would be so grateful if you left me a review over on iTunes as well. Those reviews help other people find my podcast, and they're also a fun for me to go in and read. You can click the link in the show notes, go to iTunes, find my podcast, then select ratings and reviews, and write a review. and let me know what your favorite part of the podcast is. Until next time, stay safe and have a fantastic rest of the day.